Okay, good morning. Let me start. Today, I'm going to finish the discussion of the structure of perturbation theory for the 5-4 theory, discussing the explicit form of the effective action for 5-4. And then we start to discuss renormalization theory for the 5-4 theory. So, I remind you first of what we did last time. We started from a classical 5-4 theory whose action was integral over the spacetime of 1/2 d mu phi squared plus m squared of phi squared plus g times factorial of 4 phi 4. I am implicitly in the Euclidean setting, but space-time, but that's, we have seen that it's easy to go back to real time. And we have seen that in order to discuss the physics of the quantum system, of this quantum field theory, a convenient and important tool is the so-called effective action, because it generates in particular all the one particle irreducible amplitudes. And from this, one comes back to the correlation function or the vacuum expectation value of products of operator in the theory. So we can go back to the vacuum expectation value of products of operators, the so-called correlation of Green functions. Okay. And last Friday, yes? Yes, I am sorry. Thank you very much. I forgot the phi squared, of course. Yes. Pardon? Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. I'm not awake, well awake. OK. Thank you very much. This was not a test, just a mistake. OK. So this effective action is defined in terms of background classical field phi, which basically is the vacuum correspond to the expectation value of the quantum field in the theory. And we got a very nice formula last Friday just by doing a calculation of this effective action in the functional integral formalism using just the saddle point approximation. And we found that so this effective action is called capital gamma of this classical background field. And we saw that it is first the classical action. This is a classical action. And then if we start to take into account what's the contribution of the fluctuation around the classical field configuration in the functional integral, performing a Gaussian integral, we get the first h-bar correction. And the correction is simply h-bar over 2 times the trace of an operator, which is the logarithm of the operator that is the second derivative of the classical action with respect to the variation of the field. So I denote this FIC. Okay, and then there are higher order correction that are more involved to compute, but that's, so this is the first or leading quantum correction. Okay. And this formula was derived, of course, in the Euclidean space-time setting. So I should specify that this is the Euclidean classical action. This is the second derivative of the Euclidean classical action. And of course, the formula, you can perform the calculation again at real time or perform a weak rotation, and you get a slightly different formula in real time setting. You simply get, let me write that slightly different, that at real time, this is the real time classical action. There is almost the same formula, simply you get an I factor. Okay. This is at real time. But you just have to be a bit careful when performing the weak rotation to go back to this formula. Okay. So I claim that these objects contains the sum of all one loop irreducible diagram of the theory defined by an action here, classical action. And this formula, in fact, is very general. It doesn't depend on the exact form of the action for a given theory. So let us apply this formula for phi 4. This is the action for phi 4. So what is this operator? This operator is phi. It means the derivative of the action, well, let me write it for a background field, when I perform a functional derivative with respect to variation of the field at two different points in space-time. Okay? And the rules of functional calculus tells us that this is simply the kernel of the operator. When I take two derivatives of this respect to, of this action with respect to phi, this gives me a Laplacian minus the scalar Laplacian. Then I get a term m squared coming from that. And then if I take two derivatives with respect to phi of g over factorial 4 phi 4, I get, of course, a phi squared with a normalization, which is plus g over 2 phi squared. So I get this operator. This is a differential operator. And I take its kernel or its matrix element between two points x and y. Okay. So this operator, by the way, in fact, it's called the Hessian of the function S. It's just the generalization of a matrix formed out of the second order derivative of a given function. So it's a Hessian of the function RS at phi, at the field configuration. Okay. So what does it mean? That this is the kernel of an operator. It means simply that this object is an operator acting on some space, let us call it on the space of functions psi of x with x on RD. So it's acting on some space of function. I won't specify exactly what is the topology, so let us call it that is the space of function L over RD in the mathematical definition, but you have to specify which norm, whether they are derivable, differentiable or not. I won't discuss that. There is a lot of, a bit of rigorous math involved in that. But basically, so this is an operator. This means that if you take a function psi, you apply this operator that depends on the function phi to the function psi, you get another function. You see? And this other function, of course, this is another function. And the value of this function at a given point x is given simply by applying this operator on the function psi. So what I'm doing is that I am first applying the Laplace operator with respect to x to the function psi of x. Then I just multiply the function psi by m squared. Okay? And then I multiply the function psi by the function phi squared. Plus g over 2 phi squared of x times psi of x, you see. Okay. So you see that this is an operator that depends on phi and that is applied on another function phi of x. So this operator doesn't act on phi itself, yes? We are evaluating the Hessian at this phi, which is the variable of the classical field. So I take a classical field, phi of x, and I compute this functional of this phi.
So phi doesn't have to be the one that minimizes
that. No, it doesn't have to be the one that minimizes this action. And it must not be this one. Because in fact, for instance, if you want to calculate the expectation value of the quantum field, you have to minimize this effective action that is different from the classical action. Okay. Yes?
When you calculate the second derivative of the action, shouldn't you have a direct delta?
Yes, no. If you have to be careful, this means the Laplace operator with respect to x times m squared times phi squared of x applied to the delta function delta of x minus y. So you see, so you have a delta kernel, which is basically the identity kernel. Here you just multiply it by something that depends on x, but here you take the derivative with respect to x of the delta function. So you get the kernel of the Laplace operator. And indeed, it's modified the function. So this is a local modification of phi. This is a non-local modification of psi, because you need to know the derivative of psi, and the second derivative of psi. So if you want, this is local. And this is non-local action. Yes? That's the definition. That's the definition of this operator.
In the definition, you've got x and y on the
yes. Here? No, they have to. This is the definition of this operator. This operator, in fact, depends. Well, so you have an operator whose matrix element depends on x and y of 2 points. It's just a generalization of a function, you see. Consider a function f of x1 up to xn. You see? The Hessian of this function, the Hessian is a matrix Hig, which is n by n, and Hig is simply the second derivative of S with respect to xi and xg. You see? So this is the definition of the Hessian matrix. So it's a matrix, n by n matrix, so you can view it as an operator acting on vectors with n components. That's exactly the same here, except that instead of being a matrix, we have an operator acting on functions. So, okay. So in all the calculations that I did on Friday, when I was writing first order derivative, second order derivative, it was always with respect to the value of phi at some given point. And then if I had two derivatives, it was at two different points, etc. Yes? No, because for the same reason. When I apply a function, if you have this Hessian, I start from a vector v that has component vi. You see, what I call the, apply this operator, this is, let us call it another vector w. So w is wi, is a vector, and wi is simply sum over g of hij wg. So you sum over, so here the x are the analogous of I and y are the analog of g, of the g. And we sum over the g in the formula. But if I sum, you see, if I use this representation with the delta function, what I have to do is to write that the second derivative, this operator, depending on phi, applied to the function psi, evaluated at point x, is given by the sum over g is replaced by an integral over y. And then I get the second, this operator taken at point x and y times psi of y. Use this representation that is explicit in x and y with the delta function, perform the integration over y, you get this that depends only on x. Okay? You see, you have to be a bit careful, but those are the rules. Okay. So these are, if you want, rules of functional derivative. Okay? Good. So, now, let us evaluate this term, this trace of logarithm of this operator for the 5-4 theory. And of course, I want to compare this abstract, you know, global compact formula to what I would expect in perturbation theory. So I will expand, perform a perturbative expansion in the coupling constant. So you see, I can rewrite this as the trace of the logarithm of this operator. I can rewrite it as minus the Laplacian plus m squared. This is the operator when g is equal to zero, plus g times the operator that is one over factorial four, one half the operator phi squared, where phi squared means multiplication by, so phi squared means multiplication by phi. So phi squared times psi of a given function x is simply phi squared of x times psi x. Okay, so it's the operation, multiplication of a function by another function. Okay? So this, I can rewrite it, of course, as trace of the logarithm of minus this operator times 1 plus g over 2 times this operator taken to the, its inverse times the operator phi squared. Okay. I've done nothing. Now I can use the fact that in general, if you have the trace of the logarithm of two matrix or two operator, this is nothing but the that's the logarithm of the determinant of the products of two operators. We know that the determinant of a product is the product of the determinant. Okay. And those are numbers, and therefore this is the trace of a logarithm of A plus trace of the logarithm of B. Okay, so we can rewrite this as the trace of the logarithm of this operator, which is basically the h-bar contribution to the effective action for the free field. And that's, well, it contains some divergence. That's the determinant of an infinite differential operator, but it's independent of phi. Okay? And then I get the trace of the logarithm of this operator, 1 plus g over 2 minus Laplacian plus m squared minus 1 times phi squared. Okay? And since I'm doing a perturbative expansion in G, I assume that G is small and expand in G. I expand the logarithm. If I expand the logarithm, these terms gives, of course, sum from k equal 1 to infinity minus 1 to the power k plus 1 divided by k, g over 2 to the power k, trace, and now I don't have a log, I have a product of this operator. Okay, so I'm doing just algebraic manipulation on operators. This is the expansion of the logarithm. So now let us look at this particular term, this k order term in the perturbative expansion. So let me write it explicitly. This is just the trace of k times this operator. Minus 1 times phi squared, etc. And I have k times. Okay? So now we have to represent, we want to represent the trace of these products of operator. There was a minus 1 here, I'm sorry, that's very important. There is a minus 1 here, because there is a minus 1 here. I want to represent this trace in position space. So remember, we already have know what is the action of the operator phi squared acting on functions, but we may ask what is the action of this operator acting on a function. So what is minus the Laplacian plus m squared taken to the power minus 1 acting on some function psi? Well, this is simply integral over dy of the kernel of this operator of apply on a function psi of y. Of course, everything is in d dimension. But what is this? This is, what is the kernel of this operator? This is nothing but minus Laplacian plus m squared times xy. We know what it is. We studied it in the quantization of the free field theory. This is simply the free propagator, which is the Fourier transform of the Euclidean propagator in momentum space k squared plus m squared. And that we have represented by just a single line joining 2 points x and y in the Feynman diagrammatic representation of Feynman amplitudes of products of operators. So it's an object that we know. Okay, so now this is simply the convolution of psi by this propagator, you see. And now what is the trace? The trace simply that we take this product of propagator and we take the same x at the end and we integrate over. So let us write this trace. So I write this as dx1. Then I have this first operator. This is the g of x1 minus some x2 times phi squared of x2. But then I have to integrate over x2 when I am taking the product. Then I am taking, applying this function. I'm applying this function to this operator. So I'm writing g of x2 minus some other point x3. Then phi squared of x3, etc., up to the last point, which is g of xk minus the final point, phi squared of the final point. And I have to integrate over xk. And what is the final point? It has to be the same point than the first one because I'm taking the trace. So this x1 is the same than this one because I'm taking the trace. Okay. You see? And that's exactly the same thing than writing that the trace of a product of two operators A and B to the power k for a matrix, you see? If A is a matrix AIG and B is a matrix BIG, this is simply AI1 G1, BG1 I2, AI2 G2, BG2 I3, etc., up to AIK GK, B GKI1 with Einstein summation. So I'm doing exactly the same formula. Okay. So this object corresponds simply to this complicated integral. Yes? Yes, I'm just using the fact that phi is a diagonal operator to integrate over just k x variable instead of k x variables and k y variable. This comes from this. Yes. Okay. And so So you see, this is just a product of operator with some phi squared. So I can rewrite this as just integral dd x1, integral dd xk, phi squared of x1 up to phi squared of xk. And then some function of x1 and xk that I can write, let us write it this gamma at order 1 of x1 up to xk, where this will be just, this is just the one loop term for the k legs generating, well, k squared, I'm sorry, 2k legs generating function of gamma of phi. So I'm just expanding. This is just the expansion at order phi squared of this term, you see. And what is this object? Since it's just a product of propagators, this function gamma 1, 1 mean one loop, okay, of x1, xn, is just the product of propagator, g of x1, x2, minus x2, g of x2 minus x3 up to g of xk minus x1. So it corresponds of a chain of propagators that are joined together and that closes itself. So it's something like you have a propagator going from point 1 to point 2. Then you have a propagator going from point 2 to point 3, etc. And at the end, so you get a chain of propagator, and to each of those propagator, in fact, you see you is attached a phi, attached two phi because I have two phi. So you see that this is just given by a one loop irreducible diagram of the phi 4 theory. One loop because it has just one loop. It is irreducible because it's one loop. So if I cut one line, it's still connected. You see? And it has 2 times k external truncated legs. Because to this diagram is associated directly a phi squared of x, not, so I don't have my loop and here some external propagator with a point x, with a point y, and phi of y, g of x minus y. I don't have this, no. What I do have is that I have, with my rules, a phi, so that I have phi of y, delta of y minus x, integrated over y. So I indeed have a truncated legs. I see, okay. So you see that finally, final result gamma of phi at one loop is given by the sum of one loop diagrams like that, I have a loop with k vertices. I have one phi, well, two phi attached. Attached to this vertices. And I have, of course, a factor here, which is, so this term is a term of order g to the power k, since I have k vertices. Vertices equivalent to having 2k external phis. Okay. And there is a factor, so there is a sign. So this is a minus g to the power k, because there is a minus 1 to the power k plus 1. And then there is a factor. Well, simply 1 over k times 2 to the power k. Okay? And you can check that this factor is the combinatorial symmetry factor coming from Wick's theorem. If you apply the rules of Feynman integrals rules and count how many ways you have to construct this irreducible Feynman diagram out of propagators and phi fields. Okay, so we recover the results of Feynman diagrams calculational rule. But we have recovered that directly from a functional integral calculation. Yes?
So what are we going to do with the other law, the first case?
Ah, no. In fact, by definition, you cannot ignore it. This first term, so the k equals 0 term, of course. Here I had, very good question. Here I had the sum from k. But you can say that the k equals 0 term is part of this expansion. The k equals 0 term, I can represent it as, this is given by trace of logarithm of minus Laplacian plus m squared. Let me rewrite it as minus the trace of the logarithm of the inverse propagator, simply because everything here are inverse propagator. And if you want the k equals 0 power of the propagator, you can write it as the logarithm of the operator. Okay. And I can rewrite it as simply minus g to the power 0 times this diagram, a closed propagator with no endpoint. Okay, so it's just a graphical representation of that. Just state that this contribution is part of the sum of irreducible two-loop diagrams simply by stating that there is an additional irreducible diagram that is the one-loop diagram with no external legs. And let me draw it like that. Okay. And finally, one last remark. Remember that here I have computed the trace of the log, but the effective action is h bar over 2 trace of the log. So there is an additional one over two factor here. Okay. And it is this factor, this combinatorial factor here, that you obtain by the Feynman rules. 1/2 times k times 2^k. Okay. Yes? Pardon? Don't I have a 1/0? Yes, and in fact, this is given by, well, this, you can write this as minus this diagram, but when you do the calculation, the effective action, so the effective action at one loop will be given by minus 1/2 this diagram plus g. Remember, I have a minus g over k minus, I have a plus g over, then I have k equal 1 to the power k with k equal 1 and 1/2. So I have 1/4 times this diagram with a phi and a phi. Then I have a minus g squared over, and then I will have this diagram, phi, 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 phi. I get a minus, and I have 4k equal 2, so I have 1/16. Okay. But just remember, this is just a graphical representation of the trace of this operator. Okay. So, this is the final result of the one loop contribution to the effective action for the 5-4 theory. Yes? Yes? Because this is the expansion of the log. So those are traces, but they come from the expansion of the trace of a log. So this is the result of expanding the trace of the log of an operator depending on phi in powers of g, or if you prefer, in powers of phi. No. Pardon? Yes. Yes. Yeah. Well, take it as a definition.
So
just. Okay. No, no. Well, I saw it's a convenient notation, but it's just a notation, okay? But if you think about what is, try to write the trace of the log of this operator in momentum space, because in momentum space, this operator is diagonalized. So in momentum space, this operator is simply integral over dx, dk, over 2 pi over d. So this is the analog in momentum space of a sum over x when you are performing a trace in position space. This is the log. There is a log. And then you have the propagator that is k squared plus m squared. So this is notation k squared. So in fact, so you see. So you take the trace of the propagator, minus 1, let's say. So in fact, you still have a momenta that is carried along this loop. And you integrate over this momenta. So there is a trace going on. There is a trace going on because there is a momentum carried along the loop. And you have to integrate over this momentum to compute the number that corresponds to this diagram. But take it this just as a definition. a notation for this term. Okay? Good. Okay. So I think we are done at that stage with discussing the general structure of perturbation theory. And now I'm going, I still have 30 minutes. So we are going to discuss now, start to discuss the physics contained in this perturbative expansion for the Phi-4 theory out of those results. So now, I start to discuss what is a normalization theory for the Phi-4 QFT. Because in order to discuss physics, we are going to see that we need a normalization. So for that, remember that, in fact, the physics contained is the vacuum expectation value of products of operator. And in particular, I'm interested in the two-point function that corresponds to the expectation value of a product of two field operators at two different points, phi of x2. Well, this is, I'm sorry, I will denote this here. Well, this is omega, where omega is a vacuum of the interacting theory. Okay? And then we shall consider also the four-point function later on, probably on tomorrow. So we know that in the free theory, this is given by the Feynman propagator. But now I am considering the interacting theory. Okay. So we know that it is given in perturbation theory by, let us write it g of x minus y of x1 minus x2. This is invariant. I won't specify I'm computing things in Euclidean or Minkowski setting because I will always be doing weak rotation. And we know that this object, g of x1 minus 2, while here, everything here are propagator for the free theory. These are propagators for the interacting theory. So we know that this object, well, it's better to write it in Fourier space, like ddk exponential ik times x1 minus x2 over 2 pi d g hat of a momentum k. Well, let me write it a momentum p, because it will be the external momentum. Okay, and we know that this, it's first given by the free propagator, minus g over 2 times this diagram, plus higher order terms, where this is 1 over p squared plus m squared. Well, I am back to Euclidean, but it's not very important. You know now the rules. Then I get minus g over 2 times, what is this? This is 1 over p squared plus m squared squared, because you have two propagators that carry an external momentum p. And then I have this diagram. Let me write this diagram T over M. So T over M will be given by the integral, d dk over 2 pi to the power d, 1 over k squared plus m squared. So now we have key, k is a momenta that is carried by this propagator. And since this is a closed propagator, we have to integrate over k. Okay? So now we know from the definition of the effective action that, in fact, if I consider the inverse of the propagator, which in Fourier space is just the inverse of the propagator as a function, 1 over g hat of p. If I make this calculation, I found indeed that this is just p squared plus m squared plus g over 2 times this function t of m. This is nothing but the Fourier transform of the two-point irreducible diagram. So once again, it is a contribution that comes from this diagram. You see? Okay? And this comes from something that I think you have seen already in the QFT 1 course. It means that if you consider, if I write the two-point irreducible function, if I write this two-point irreducible function, let me call it gamma hat of p, as the free propagator, inverse propagator that I've denoted by this double truncated, and then I had a plus of a sum sigma of irreducible diagrams. Okay, then its inverse, g hat of p, which is gamma hat of p minus 1, is simply this propagator, the inverse of this, minus g times 1 propagator, 1 irreducible diagram, 1 propagator, plus g squared times 1 propagator, 1 irreducible diagram, 1 propagator, 1 irreducible diagram, 1 propagator, plus et cetera. It's something that we have already seen. Okay. So you see that the propagator, this is the propagator we are interested in. Then we have terms of order g squared. And in this calculation, I have set h bar equal 1, because each time that you have a g, you have a factor h bar. So performing an h bar expansion in h bar or an expansion in g at that level is the same thing. Okay? You see that the free propagator is modified by this one loop contribution. Okay. And the problem is that this integral here that represents the Feynman integral for the so-called tadpole diagram, this integral is divergent. Here. When you try to perform the integral at k equal infinity. Okay? Now, oops. What is the physics? Yes?
And we know that the gamma hat, the.
Yes?
The, I guess, what's that, the propagator for the irreducible diagrams?
Yes?
Like, how do we know the connection between that and the propagator?
Well, here, in fact, this is a proof, it's just a diagrammatic proof. Okay? But now there is a general argument. It's valid for any theory. It's one of the properties of the Legendre transform. Remember, gamma of phi. Well, gamma of phi is a Legendre transform. So it's W of G. Remember, I'm sorry, minus W of G plus G phi, with phi equal dW over G G. This is a Legendre transform. And a general property of the Legendre transform is that if you take, since you have this property, if you take the second derivative of phi with respect to g, so let me assume that this is phi of x and g of x. This is, in fact, the second derivative of y. So this is a propagator between x and y. The sum of all connected, remember. Now, since this is d phi over dg, we can rewrite this as the inverse of dg over d phi. You see? Between the point x and y. And delta g of x versus delta phi of y, if you compute it, the property of the Legendre transform is that if phi of x is delta w over dg of x, g of x is delta gamma of phi divided by gamma of I of x. Because the Legendre transform is an involution. Therefore, this is, of course, the second derivative of gamma of phi delta phi of x delta phi of y. You see. So this is just a mathematical theorem which tells you that if, when you change the variables, the matrix, Jacobian matrix of the change of variables, if you go from variable x to variable y, or if you go from variable y to variable x, the Jacobian matrices of partial derivative are just the inverse. So we just use these properties that the Jacobians are inverse, and the fact that the Legendre transform is an involution. While this is, you get that the two-point irreducible function is the inverse of the two-point function. Yes?
When you say that gamma is 1 over g, it should be understood that you are amputating the legs of the diagram, right? And it's just not the inverse of the propagator, but the inverse is amputated.
Yes, of course. Here, this is a reducible part, so I have amputated the line. Yes, yes. Just the standard definition. Okay, I'm sorry, I have to go fast because I want to explain a few important things before the end of the lecture. Okay. So, so this integral is divergent at k equals 0, and we have seen that, in fact, this comes from the short distance divergence of the propagator. Okay. But now we have to understand what is the physical information contained in this two-point propagator. And I started to explain on Thursday, on Friday, I don't remember, that in fact, if we consider the two-point function, a pole in the two-point function corresponds to a particle with a mass m squared given by minus p squared if I have a pole at even value of the p. And this, I mentioned the theorem that I'm going to explain a little bit more during the last 15 minutes, and you will work on it on the tutorial. This theorem is related to a well-known, Kaelin theorem, which is called the Kaelin-Lehmann spectral representation. Okay. Which is a result of general quantum field theory considered in the canonical framework. So forget for a minute the functional integral. I think I will need that. So let me erase this. So consider a quantum field theory. Consider a general quantum field theory whose spectrum contains a massive spin zero particle at the moment, it will be general, as lowest excitation. It's really a theory that describes interacting particles. Okay, so we know that the spectrum, of course, contains the vacuum state, whose energy is, of course, zero by definition of the vacuum state, and it is a Poincaré invariant. If you apply a Lorentz transformation and translation of the vacuum, you get the same state. Then you have one particle state that are characterized by the momentum, let us call it K. So this will be one particle state. I put an index one, but just to mean that it is one particle state. It has a space momentum k, so its total momentum k is E k, the energy and the spatial momentum, with, of course, with by definition, E squared equal k squared plus m squared. Okay. And then it might have a possible bound state, for instance. Imagine that it has an attractive interaction, so there is stable bound state, a bound state that can only decay into the particles. So it will be also characterized by its momentum, but by a different mass. So this will be E prime k with E prime squared equal k squared plus the mass m prime of the bound state. And the bound state will be stable in some sense if the m prime is less than the mass of two particles, so they cannot decay, etc. And then it has, of course, two particle states. But the state doesn't need to be bounded, three particle states, etc. So it has a lot of particle states that I, of course, characterized by a momentum. by an energy, and let me denote that by some index lambda, just continuous index. That label that, for instance, you may have a particle set where you have two particles which goes like that, or two particles that go like that, etc. So that's just, you know, the distribution of relative velocities of the particle, etc. Okay. Okay. And so, and of course, these particles have now some energy E and some momentum K. But E depends on lambda. Okay? Good. So, of course, what does it mean? It means that I'm looking at the spectrum of the theory in momentum and energy. First, I have the ground state. So, first, I have the vacuum. Then, I have the one particle state. Then, I have possibly this bound state. This is at M. And then I have a continuum of n particle states. Okay, this is a spectrum of the theory. Okay? So now let us consider the following object. We define the spectral function associated, in fact, it associated to the field operator phi of x, the operator that creates the field, quantum of fields of the theory. And it is defined in the following way. We consider the states, lambda k with zero momenta in a given frame, and we denote those just lambda. So you see, so what are those lambda? Well, this is the first state, one particle at rest. This will be the second state, one bound state at rest. And then you have a whole continuum of bound state. So there are n particle states. Simply, this is an n particle state like that, where the sum of the momenta of the various particles sums out to zero. So the particles are moving, but the center of mass is at rest. Okay, so in general, it's state at rest. Okay? And then let us consider mu, some energy parameter. And I define this spectral function rho of mu squared, so it's a function of the square of some energy, as 2 pi times the sum over all those states, So it's a sum over the spectrum of the theory, if you want. All the states in the spectrum of the theory. I consider the matrix element of the phi operator at the origin between the vacuum and this state at rest. I take the square of the modulus, so this is a real number, and I take a delta function of mu squared minus the mass. So such a state as, if k equals zero, E lambda is equal to the mass at rest of this. You see. So such a state, if I have a state at rest, so k equals zero, it has an energy E lambda, or m lambda. I'm sorry. M, yes. Okay, so you see, this is a function which is just the density function. It tells you, I count how many states have energy rest mu squared, and then I take the, so this is basically the density of states, density of states with energy mu and momentum zero, and I multiply this density of state by this matrix, the square of this matrix element, which tells you basically what is the probability, the quantum probability. It's not a probability amplitude, it's a probability because it's a square, the modulus of square of a matrix element. It tells you the probability to create the state lambda when applying the field operator on the vacuum. See? Okay. And this is called the spectral function. Okay. So basically, well, this spectral function has the following check, the following this spectral function has the following features. I want to write rho as mu squared as a function of mu. Okay? So, first, or mu squared, let us say, m squared. So first I have a delta function at the particle. So this is a one particle. Eventually, I have another delta function if I have some bound state. So this is the particle state, this is 2 prime. And then at 4m squared, remember that the energy for a 2 particle state is 2 times. So the energy squared is 4 sine squared. I start to have a continuum. Density of state. Okay? Yes?
More question. Is there any particular reason why pi is evaluated at zero?
Yes, because that's well, it's not very important. You can take phi at a point different from the origin, because if phi is not at the origin, you can always make a translation if you make just a translation, a state with zero momenta will stay the same. It's translationally invariant. And the vacuum is invariant under translation, too. So this doesn't change the value of the square. This might change by a phase, but eventually, but this doesn't change this matrix element. So. Yes.
Continuous index, but how does it behave under quantary transformation? Does it change?
No, no. This state lambda is a state taken at zero momenta. If you make a Lorentz boost, then it changes its momenta.
But the thing is that, I mean, this index lambda is a new index that we're putting back.
No, out, right? this index lambda is just a mathematical notation. It's a poor mathematical notation for a mathematician, but it's just a way to state that you have a lot of states, you see. And, well, here I have a particle, but here you may have a continuum of particles of different shapes. You may have higher excitation, so you may have the particles moving there and the particles moving here, but you might also have one and two. So you have n particle states with the different particles in the theory. So you might have states made out of these particles, and then you might have states made out of these particles plus this particle somewhere here. So it's a whole mixture of states. I'm not very interested in what they are because I'm just interested into the continuum density of state. So that's a notation. And that's a notation, in fact, that I found, I think, in the book by Peskin and Schroeder. So it's not, it's a standard notation. Okay, what's important is this function, you see. Okay, so this is the shape of the function. So now, so I have defined the spectral function. But why is it useful? It is useful because of the following result. If I consider the two-point function, function as defined above, but now in Fourier space. So I consider that g hat of k is integral d4k 2 pi to the power 4 e minus I. Well, here it's an I, but it's not important. K times x minus y. The vacuum expectation value of those phi of x, phi of y, omega, with the same field operator phi, but now at different point. So I just consider the Fourier transform of the two-point function of the interacting theory. Then, if you write this as in terms of you can write always this vacuum expectation value of products of two operators between the vacuum by inserting the other states of the spectrum and summing over the momenta and the lambda. Sum over lambda and k. And then, so if you insert, then you use Lorentz symmetry, the Poincaré symmetry. You can transform this into such matrix element. And the final result, it is this Chalon-Lehmann representation. This Chalon-Lehmann representation means simply that this g hat of k. Now I am in a momentum space, in a real time space. I'm sorry. This is a real time formulation. This is simply given by the integral over the whole energy mu squared. Well, there is a 2 pi normalization factor. It is this spectral function, rho of mu squared, And something's very simple. It is simply the Feynman propagator. At momentum k. Okay. So this formula is quite simple. And it's very beautiful. It expresses the two-point function, so the propagator of the interacting theory. Just in terms of its spectral function and of the propagator of the free field theory. Okay. Yes?
So to use this, don't we need to know primarily what the spectrum of our theory
is? Yes, you need to know what the spectrum of the theory is. And what are the matrix elements? Yes, yes, yes. But remember, what is k squared? K squared in my notation is minus e squared plus k squared, because I'm using a minus plus 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 convolution. So you integrate over a function that is measurable. So this is, of course, a measurable function. Okay. Times this Feynman propagator, you see. So if the particle has a bound, one particle state at the mass m squared, you see. When I integrate over the mu, g hat of k, there is a term of the form 1 over 2 pi. There is a contribution coming from this Dirac position. I get rho of mu squared. You see, rho of mu squared is a delta function. So I get a 1 over 2 pi. I get the 2 pi, so the 2 pi disappear, in fact. So I get one contribution, which is the matrix element of the one particle state of phi between 0 and the one particle state. I over k squared plus m squared minus I epsilon plus terms that are over the 1 when k is close to minus m squared. Because you see, when I compute this integral, I first get the contribution of this when I integrate over mu, this delta function at mu squared equal m squared, plus the remaining contribution. And the remaining contribution are over the 1, while this becomes divergent. At k squared equal minus squared, you see. So in an interacting theory, from this Chern-Lehmann representation, the two-point function, if you consider it as a function of k squared, it has a pole at k squared equal minus m squared. You see. And this follows just from this result. So now, just I end up here. Remember, since g hat of p is the inverse of gamma hat of p, gamma hat of p If I consider it as a function of p squared, in the p squared complex plane, it's a perfectly well-defined function. In this side, it has a pole here. No, it has a zero here at p squared equal minus m squared, where m is the mass of the one particle state. And okay. And then, of course, it might have a pole corresponding to the bound state, and then it will have a cut here at minus 4m squared. But here it has a zero. It has no zero here. See. Yes? Oh, because you see, this is a positive function. It's a sum of positive matrix element. So if k squared is positive, up to the I factor, let's say. This is positive, so this function cannot be equal to zero. Or this function cannot diverge, so its inverse cannot have a zero. You see? It just comes from the positivity. So it's a measurable positive function. If it was negative, it would mean that the square, the modulus of some matrix element would be negative, which means that the theory is not unitary. Okay? Good. So if you are able to, if you have a complicated theory, but you know how to compute its two-point function, looking at the pole of the two-point function, the first pole in the complex plane, tells you what is the mass of the theory. Okay. And application. Phi saw theory at one loop. What is the mass? This particle has, there is a pole at, there is a zero of gamma 2 of p at p squared equal minus m squared plus g over 2 t of m. So the particle, the theory has a particle, it describes a particle, but the mass is renormalized. So there is a particle with mass m that I will call a physical particle, with a mass m that I called m physical, and the physical mass is simply given by the m squared we started from, plus g over 2 t of m. So we have computed at first order in h bar the mass of the theory. Of course, there will be corrections. But you see that the mass of the particle is not the mass parameter we had in the original action. It's renormalized. So this phenomenon is called mass renormalization. The mass of the first physical excitation above the vacuum of the theory is indeed a particle, but it's a particle with a mass that is different from the original m we had in the action. The mass is renormalized. And so I will discuss what renormalization means tomorrow, and we'll explain why The fact that there is a mass renormalization is not at all surprising. That's an effect that already appears in classical, well, even in classical physics, but in quantum mechanics. The mass of electrons is renormalized in metals or in conductors. But the point is that this is infinite. So that's, we have to understand what's going on here. OK? Thank you. And sorry for being a bit late.